What I will be talking about is two of the most basic classes of components in McStas, sources and monitors. Obviously, you need some kind of source in order to get some neutrons or some rays going at all. If not, there's nothing to look at. And you also need some monitors. If you don't have monitors, there's no way to. You're not actually looking at the neutrons. You're generating neutrons, but you're not actually looking at it. So what we'll be doing now is, firstly, I will do a short talk on what sources in general, what monitors in general do. Then we'll do a short, very, very simple exercise. And then we'll go back and take a closer look at both sources and monitors and some of the models that we have. And look at some particularities of those. And then we'll do a little bit of an exercise on that as well. Experienced McStas users might find this difficult, but in order to get everyone on the same page, this is by experience a good way to do it. So, a source component, as you probably gathered from Peter already, it really means to generate the neutron rays. And in McStas terms, this means to set the neutron state to something that represents the source we're trying to model. And to put that in more mathematical context, it really means insert values into the neutron state vector, which is the PU. A neutron ray McStas is represented by 11 parameters, as you've heard already. So position, velocity vector, time, polarization vector, and a weight. And these values that we insert into this state vector should be drawn then from the appropriate distributions that represent appropriate probability distributions that represent your source. So we'll do an example now where we sample neutrons from a uniform wavelength distribution that emerge from a circular aperture. This would correspond to having a disc-shaped moderator with a rather unusual wavelength spectrum, I suppose. But first, a slight diversion here. Documentation. Documentation is always very important, and we try to do this in McStas. There's a component manual. There's a manual for the whole system, and there's also a component manual that helps you, that describes the models that are used in each component that we distribute. It's available here in the PDF form, following that link. It's also distributed on along with McStas itself, so it's already on your system. If you've got McStas there, you can, in a terminal, write mcdoc -c, and it will try to open this this document for you. Or if you're searching for documentation on a particular, you can write and some search string that represents the source you're looking for, that will then open a browser window with the docs documentation available for that particular component or those particular components that match the search. Okay, so those are your best friends when using McStas. So back to the example here. We have this circular source, circular disk, and we basically draw position vectors from this. We assume that the origin of the neutron rays are uniformly distributed along the disk. So we basically draw an x coordinate from minus radius to plus radius, and y coordinate similarly, and we make sure that the sum of the squares is less than the radius itself. And that generates these stars, star positions. We assume the source to be in z equals 0. So since it is a disk, we can assume that one coordinate is 0. So the blue lines here are possible velocity vectors. assume that this circular disk just emits neutrons in every direction. Now, we also want the wavelength distribution to be uniform, and the length of the velocity vector is what encodes the wavelength of these neutrons. As you know, the wavelength of a neutron corresponds to a function of its velocity, and the speed of the neutron corresponds to the length of the velocity vector. So, this is what I'm trying to show here in math. And since we know that the wavelength distribution is uniform or across some interval, in this case from 1 to 4 angstrom, we get the velocity vector, the length of the velocity vector, immediately as a function of that. Now, next bit, as you remember from Peter, we don't really want to simulate neutrons going in every which way, every direction, because that would be statistically inefficient. We usually have some kind of aperture that we're interested in. In the case of a neutron instrument, that's usually the opening of a guide or something like that. And that is the reason for making it this way, that we have a region of interest, you could call it, that we focus at. This is not an optical focus or anything, it's just a sampling focus. Some people call it important sampling or stratified sampling or something like that. Basically, what it means is that if we think of a window of a certain width and height, we place it at some distance from the disk, and we ensure that all of the neutron velocities that we generate hit this disk. Now, if we just did that, that would mean that we would be oversampling this, because remember that we thought of the neutrons emerging from this disk to be going in every direction. But we now say that we guarantee that these neutrons will eventually hit this window. That means that we have to downweight. We adjust the weight so according to the size of this window and how much of the unit sphere around the disk it then subtends.
Excuse me. If the focus is set up, so all neutrons will follow in the arrow.
Yeah. Unless there is something in between here, they will eventually hit this area.
But is any way to decide the proper focusing dimension?
If you want to really do an optical focus, is that what you're...
Yes, I don't how to set the value, in order to speed up the simulation. So we want to just use some neutron in.
These are just parameters to the source. I will show you how to use the source. It comes along.
So one rule of thumb is you have your first optical device, mm-hmm. It has a certain width and height. Then that's that's probably the dimensionality of this. You should at least be very careful not to under-illuminate.
It needs to be big enough so that anything to cover the acceptance window of your first optical component. If the first optical component is round, then this focusing square has to be big enough to
But how to define big enough? I know that's should be bigger.
One way is to put a monitor around the front. So you put a monitor around the front and you see an image that corresponds then to the size, and then it should be fine.
Yes. Another way is to gradually increase the size of it until you don't gain any. At the point where you don't gain any more intensity by increasing the focusing window, you know that you cover whatever acceptance window you happen to have. If you don't know what the So in code, this would look something like this. I'm only taking a piece of the instrument file here, where in the trace section, if you remember from last demo, this is where you put your components in. I put in an origin. This is just a progress bar, making sure that we have an absolute value or that we have a coordinate system. And then I put in a simple, this source simple. It has a radius of 5 centimeters. This is a way of ensuring the lambda parameters, lambda zero and the lambda. It's a way of specifying the uniform wavelength distribution by means of a center wavelength and a half wavelength spread. And we specify a focusing window to be 10 by 10 centimeters at a distance of 5 meters. And that just sets the focusing window at 5 meters from your source disk and with its aperture. So, back to the monitors. This is slightly repeating what Peter has already said, but in reality, generally speaking, when people talk about, and when I talk about reality, I mean actual neutron instrumentation that you guys actually do. When people talk about a monitor, it's usually some kind of intensity probe or the beam, which is mostly transparent to neutrons. It only eats about at a very low efficiency, generally speaking, not to affect the beam as much as possible, to avoid affecting the beam as much as possible. Whereas a detector, on the other hand, should detect all neutrons existing that arrive, and efficiency should be as high as possible. Now, in McStas, we tend to just talk about monitors, and what we mean by monitors is something that encompasses both of these things. We can have monitors to behave basically any which way we want them to, but we just refer to these things as monitors, and they have by definition an efficiency of 100%. If we have a beam monitor, it monitors that beam, and everything that passes through that with a complete efficiency, and it also has a transparency of 100%, which means that you monitor very efficiently, but you don't affect the beam. That's the whole point. That also means that we can have just about as many monitors as we want. So, at any point up in the beam, you can have a monitor showing you what the beam looks like, which is very useful when it comes to, you don't actually have to only have one detector at some point at the end of your instrument. You can monitor the beam as it goes along, you can see what, in which way has this optical component changed my beam. This is a important take-home message here, is use a lot of monitors, basically. It helps you a lot. There is an exception to this, which is the PSD detector component that really models a helium-3 detector in terms of helium-3 pressures and so on and so forth. That really does the physical computation of the helium-3 detector. And this is the reason to have that is basically to get as close to reality as possible and to enable comparing actual absolute intensities to simulations in the end. So, taking a step back, looking closely at the PSD monitor and seeing what that does. It's a square, and we divide it into pixels. And we transport neutrons, and they hit somewhere, and they eventually hit some pixel. And we store, for each pixel, we store a number as we go along in the simulation. And in the end, when the simulation is completed, the detected intensity in a particular pixel is actually the sum of all rays, the sum of the weight of all the rays that had to hit this pixel. As you remember, the weight is get the actual estimated intensity on in a single pixel. So, and during the simulation, these are just computed as running sums, which means it's just a simple way of recording these things. And in code, again, remember the source simple. We can simply put in a PSD monitor. And in this case, I've also put in an L monitor, which is a single and a screen. But instead of recording intensity as a spectral function, we record it as a function of whatever wavelength it happens to have. So it's you can think of it as one big wavelength, one big wavelength sensitive pixel instead. You can see that the input parameters are pretty much similar. It has the filing and its height and width. The only thing with the lambda monitor is also needs to know which wavelength range you're actually monitoring. And to take a little step back and look at mathematical sources, what I mean by mathematical sources is sources that don't really correspond to any real source, such as source simple, which can have a square or a circular surface that emits neutrons from either a uniform or a Gaussian wavelength distribution, and neutrons are directed towards a square target, as you is focusing on your idea. There's a different one called source dip, which just has instead of having this focusing window, it has a defined divergent area that you use to define the emitted neutrons. It can be either uniform or Gaussian. Now, if you do this MacDoc source simple, or in the GUI you go help in MacDoc component reference, and then in the web page you click source simple, you get a web page like this. So this is again back to the actual documentation that we do distribute with MacStas. You get a web page. It's quite difficult to read it here, but instead of on your computers, if you will, then you get some identification. You get some description of what this component is supposed to be doing, who wrote it, and when. And if you also then click the input parameter one, you get a picture like this, where you got all the input parameters that are possible for this this model. This goes for any component in MacStas. So it's not in any way limited to sources or anything like that. These are all the parameters that source simple understands. Some of them are optional. For instance, you can use either a radius or a width and a height. So that means you have a question? Source simple, and also a PSD, position sensitive some looking at more in depth on what different sources do. Now, is it possible? Can we access these?
Yes.
So, please follow this link, and there should be instructions on how to get on it. And we will, I will try to move around and see.
So maybe if you click here and escape or click on here,
yeah.
You can actually take a Safari there.
Yeah.
We do CSNS 2019.mcstas.org. And this will give you this page.
Yes.
I think I'll suppress that agenda there, put a screenshot instead. And then the first link will take you to the school resources.
Yes. That was better. And then we can go to monitors. Monday. Source monitors. And then there's something here.
Okay. Yes. So there's a little text to read and a few tasks and
yes.
you just go ahead and you raise your hand or shout out or whatever.
Yep.
And we'll be right with you. So you head over to csns2019.mcstas.org and you take the first link.
Yeah. have now input A source signal. My source signal does not have to be the same as yours. That's really... I now go to this window. Start my simulation. I get something that looks like this. So in this case, my wavelength, it's difficult to see here, but my wavelength distribution goes from 9 angstrom to 1 angstrom, which is not exactly what I want. And you can see also that my PSD is fully covered by neutrons. So that means if I either I've made my PSD exactly the right size, or I've made it too big, or I've made it too small. So I'll make it a little bit bigger by adjusting the width and height parameters just to see. Is that I think. So that means that I now know for sure that I catch all of the neutrons that I have emitted from the source. Now, we can think of this, I'll get back to that, but the blue region here, which has intensity zero, that doesn't exactly mean that we know that there is no intensity. That means that we have no Monte Carlo estimate of the intensity here. We don't actually, we don't emit any neutrons that will hit the region which is blue, which means that we don't have any. The point I'm trying to make is that here we don't actually compute anything there, so we don't have an estimate, so we don't really know anything about it. Therefore, it's the only sensible thing that we can do is set it to zero, but in a sense, we actually don't know what it is. But in this case, we only